Good morning, students. As you can see that I have written the topic atomic structure of class 11th. So what I will do is, I will not teach you the topic which are there already in class 9th and you have studied, like the atomic models given by Dalton's atomic theory, atomic model given by Rutherford's atomic theory, atomic model given by Bohr's atomic theory. What I will do is, I will tell you those skills which are required to understand and solve problems for this chapter particularly. So what we will do is, first of all, we will try to understand the atoms and its structure from its orbital point of view. Alright. So before that, a few rules we will see and a few concepts about the structure of atom we will see. The most accepted structure of the atom, if we combine all the good points of Dalton's atomic theory, Rutherford's atomic theory and Bohr's atomic model, then according to that, the most accepted atomic model looks like this. Say for example, if I draw structure of sodium atom, then its atomic number has to be written at the bottom and the mass number has to be written at the top like this, such that this is mass number, not atomic mass, this is mass number. Mass number means sum of number of protons plus number of neutrons, whereas atomic number, this is atomic number, and this is necessarily number of protons only. In case of a neutral atom, the number of protons should be equal to number of electrons. So if I ask you, what will be the atomic number? What will be the atomic number of Na plus ion? Option A 11, option B 12, option C 10, or option D 23. Now I am not talking about the atomic number of sodium atom, I am talking about sodium ion. Now here your decision making skill is required. As we know that the atomic number is equal to number of proton, so for the ions also the number of protons are equal to 11 itself. So A is the right answer and all these are wrong answers. Now what if I talk about gain of electron, like what will be the atomic number of chloride ion? Now chlorine atom has 17 electrons. Chlorine atom has 17 electrons, so chlorine ion will have one more electron. So should its atomic number become 18? If its atomic number becomes 18, then we will not call chlorine ion as chlorine ion, rather we will call it as argon. So atomic number never changes in case of cation or in case of anion. For this also, the atomic number is equal to 17, and for this also the atomic number is equal to 17, because the number of protons inside the nucleus of any atom does not change. Whatever change is taking place in the outermost shell of the atom. When I say outermost shell of the atom, for sodium I mean 2 electrons in the first orbit, 8 electrons in the second orbit, and 1 electron had to be there which is not there, and hence it is a Na plus ion. But for case of sodium, it will be 2 electrons in the first shell, 8 in the second shell, 3rd shell 1. So this is valence cell. The outermost shell is also called as valence cell. In case of chlorine atom, so for if I take chlorine atom, in the first shell there will be 2 electrons, in the second cell there will be 8 electrons, and the third cell there will be 7 electrons. So chlorine atom will always have a tendency to take one electron from someone. So who will be that one? Sodium. Sodium has tendency to lose one electron, and chlorine has tendency to take one electron. Where will they be? Where they will take electron? In the outermost cell. Alright. So if they will take electron, then their atomic number will not change. Their atomic number will remain same. But what change will occur is the number of electrons in their outermost cell. So, to understand the chemical property of any chemical species, we have to understand where a particular electron is lying. Particularly in case of valence cell, what is the condition of that electron? Whether that electron is moving in the clockwise direction, whether the electron is moving in the anticlockwise direction, or if there are two electrons moving in two opposite directions and hence they are acting as lone pair, or if they are moving in only one direction, it has some magnetic moment as a result of which it is trying to attract some other electron. Say if it is moving in this direction, so it needs another electron which can move in this direction. So to understand all these things, we need to understand more deeper view of the arrangement of electron in the outermost cell of any atom. So, the study of the arrangement of electron in the subsequent shells of any atom is called as its electronic configuration. In our generation, these words configuration used to be, you know, heard first time in the chemistry lesson itself. But in your generation, you might have used this word a number of times when you might have been purchasing some digital devices. Like you might have asked your retail person in the computer showroom that what is the configuration of the computer. Then in the configuration of the computer, the salesman tells you about what are the features, what are the components available, what are the longevity, what is the quality, all that. Similarly, the arrangement of the electron in the subsequent orbits gives us the qualitative and the quantitative properties of any atom. Whether any atom will be reactive, whether any atom will not be reactive, can be understood by just seeing its electronic configuration, because it is the outermost electron which takes part in the chemical reaction. It is the outermost electron which takes part in the chemical reaction. It is the hand which we use for shaking with our friends. We don't shake our internal organs, we don't shake our stomach or lungs, we shake our hand. Isn't it? Similarly, when two atoms come in close to each other, then their first point of interaction is with the outermost electron. So after arranging the electrons in the subsequent orbits, we will see that how the property of the atom depends upon the valence shell of any atom. For that, we need to understand that what a shell of an atom further contains inside it. Alright? So we will be seeing filling up of the electron in the atomic orbitals, not orbits, orbitals. So I'll tell you the concept about orbitals right now itself. I'll have to erase it now. This word you are very much accustomed to, Now the word which I am using is atomic orbital. These two words are entirely different. Atomic orbit is the circular path around the nucleus. Where electrons are expected to revolve. But orbital is the space around the nucleus. Where probability of finding electron is maximum. Probability of finding electron in that space is maximum. Now these are the circular paths, the first orbit, the second orbit, third orbit, which we were naming as K shell, L shell, M shell and so on. But orbitals are like, if it is the first orbital which is closest to the nucleus, if it is closest to the nucleus, then the probability of finding the two electrons in the first orbit is uniform throughout, because it is a very small space. If you will be living in a small room, so your probability of being found out will be very easy, because you are living in a very small room. But if you live in a big villa, then it is very difficult to understand in which room you are living. So far you go from the nucleus, the probability of locating the electron becomes lesser and lesser, as a result of which what happens, the orbitals which are close to the nucleus, they assume a space which is uniform all around the nucleus. So what can be that closed geometric three-dimensional figure which can be three-dimensionally uniform all around? Sphere. So the spherical orbital is called as S orbital. Its types are S orbital. In case of S orbital, the probability of finding electron is uniform all around. Electron can be found all around. Next is P orbital. Say for example, if you have gone to a resort and their water park is also there, the instruments for, you know, merry-go-round is also there, cafeteria is also there, and I am also there for teaching. So where will be your more probability of being found? Will you be found near me? No. You will try to be in a preferable area where you can have fun, isn't it? Whatever will attract you more, you will try to be there. Now the place where you will be crowded, where you students will be more crowded, that will be written as a swollen balloon kind of a structure. And the place where very less number of successful people will be there with me, that will be shown like a point. So that kind of structure is shown like a dumbbell shaped structure, where this point is showing minimum probability and this point is showing the maximum probability. And what about this then? It is two-dimensionally available. Okay, so P orbital is two-dimensionally available. So these are like phases. It is not positive or negative. If I write, I don't mean to say that it is electrically positive or negative. It shows phases, means direction, upward direction and lower direction. This point is called as node, where probability of finding electron is minimum, and the plane where the node is, this plane is called as nodal plane. So this is the shape of p orbital. Similarly, the shape of d orbital is double dumbbelled. Now if it is double dumbbelled, it can be oriented in 5 different directions. How? I will use this space now. Atomic orbits, you all very know, very well know what it is. So not much discussion is required. 5 degenerate d orbitals are here. The word degenerate means of equal level. They are all of equal potential energy level. So when in science any system is at the same level of their potential energy, then we call them as to be in the degenerate state. Alright, so they are degenerated. So all these d orbitals, irrespective of how they are oriented, like if they are oriented in the xy direction, so this is xy plane. Or if they are in z plane, or they are in zx plane, or they are in a diagonal plane. Dx square minus y square, or they are touching all the faces of the square in a box such that this becomes condensed and forms a collar. It's called as dz square. If you want, I can show these d orbitals in a three-dimensional box also. What I mean to say is, if this is a three-dimensional box, then dxy will be this one. Then d z y will be this one. Similarly, d z x will be this one. Dx square minus y square will be the one which will be touching the diagonal. One d orbital will be touching all the faces. One will be above the plane, below the plane, and the other in between the faces will repel it and will form a collar. So it might be looking very much congested. So now what I can do is, I can make the boxes like this. See, this is one box. Similarly, I can make 5 boxes and I can show you. Now, each of these, although they are not separate, but for our understanding, we can make them separate and we can understand. Which one would you like me to make? I can make this one. This is one plane. In this plane, d orbital is like this. This is dxy. Similarly, this plane. The plane of your bed. Which plane is in which plane is your bed? Your bed is in xz plane. So this is x dxz. One plane could be this. The plane of the door. The plane at which the door of the house is there. It is y, this is z. So d yz. One plane which touches all the four surfaces. This one, this one, this one, this one. And the one which touches all the corners. So any two of these will form a collar. It's called as dz square. Now how this name dx square minus y square has come? For diagonal plane. For the diagonal plane, how the word dx square minus y square has come? There is one concept in chemistry which is called as group theory. In group theory, we study about symmetry. Alright. So, in symmetry, it is not as simple as symmetrical triangles. So, it has some concept. You know, some abstract concepts of finding out symmetry is there. So, these are all those symmetry-based or point group-based terms which are used here, which we will be understanding in our higher classes. As of now, we have to understand that d orbitals are of five types: dxy, dyz, dzx, dx square minus y square, and dz square. Similarly, p orbital can be in three axes. This is y, it can be in the zx, or it can be in the z axis also. So p orbital can be of three types: px, py, and pz. So three orbitals we have seen. S orbital is spherical. So spherical means it is oriented in all directions. So x, y, z is not applicable in this. P orbital has two lobes of probability. So it will be either in x plane or y plane or z plane. So there are three p orbitals: px, py, and pz. D orbitals has got four probability lobes. So these are all of five types: dxy, yz, zx, x square minus y square, and dz square. F orbitals being very away from the nucleus are not having any particular shape. Alright, so they do not have any particular shape. Although the suborbitals in the F orbital is 7. Number of suborbital in the F orbital is equal to 7. This we can calculate mathematically. Alright. So we will see now how the electrons are arranged and how will you write the electronic configuration which you used to write down earlier using KLMN method. Now you will write in terms of SPDF method. So we will be traveling from known to unknown zone. So topic which we will be seeing is filling up of atomic orbitals. Now there are a few rules. These rules we will not mug up, but what we will do is we'll apply our logic and then we will learn them. First of all, we will come up to that particular rule by our own thinking, and once we adopt that thinking as an agreeable concept, then we will level those theory as the rules given by certain scientists. So there are two ways: either you can learn those rule, or you can deduce them also, and then you can relate them with those rules. So I think that second method will be more useful. So let us see. So far, for hydrogen, if somebody would have asked you to write down atomic configuration, you would have simply wrote K equal to 1. What about helium? You could have written K is equal to 2, and L is equal to 0, and M is equal to 0, and so on. Lithium, K is equal to 2, L is equal to 1, and so on. Let us take the example of calcium. 20. So we write K is equal to 2, L is equal to 8, then again M is equal to 8, and then N is equal to 2. My question is, why? When in third orbit you can fill 18 electrons, as per the rule, we can fill 2 electrons in the first orbit, 8 electrons in the second orbit, and we can fill 18 electrons in the third orbit. Then why are we splitting it into 8 plus 2? Have you ever given a thought on this? What I mean to say is, how do we write the atomic configuration of calcium? 2 electron, then 8 electron, then again 8 electron, and then 2 electron. And then we say that it loses 2 electron and to form calcium 2 plus ion. But what I mean to say is, if you apply 2n square rule in the M shell, that means first, second, third, in the third cell there should be 18 electrons. So why can't we keep these 2 electrons here? If you would have asked this question in class 9th or 10th, your teacher might have asked you that you will understand in the future classes. So that time has come now that I will be splitting these orbits into orbitals. You have to understand these orbits into orbitals. The first orbit K contains S only. The second orbit L contains S and P only. The third orbit contains S, P and D only. And the fourth orbit contains S, P, D and F only. As many atoms are discovered so far, and as many number of electrons are there so far, the G orbital has not come into use. So up to F, we will be able to fill up all the electrons. Okay. Now, we will fill up the electrons of the calcium according to the orbital concept. For the first cell, we will write 1. This has to be small letter, 1s2. For second shell, we will write 2s2 and 2p6. For third, we will write 2s2, 2p6 and 3d, sorry, this is third, 3s2. 3p6, 3d0 and 4s2. That means we have gone to the nth orbit. We have not filled up this electron here. What we have done? Instead, we have filled up the electron in the fourth cell. What is the reason? Why we have done that? The reason is very simple. That when you climb up in the stair, you are increasing your potential energy. So when you climb up in the stair, when you are increasing your potential energy, why should you like to go somewhere very higher without reaching the lower one at first? So you will go step by step. Now you will say that, sir, 3D comes before 4S. So 3D has to be filled up at first. Yes. although it is looking here when we are writing in this array, but in the atomic structure 4d comes after 3d comes after 4s. 3d comes after 4s. All right, now what is the reason behind that? So there is one rule which you have to now understand. This rule is termed as Aufbau rule. The filling up of the electron in the subsequent orbital takes place such that first electrons fill up in the lower energy level and then fills in energy level. It might be looking very big statement for you. I will make it very small. Just remember it, that when electron rises up in the stair, first of all it steps in the lower step and then it goes to the higher step. Now the picture is clear. The same staircase which I am talking about, this staircase is related with the level of the energy of the orbital. Level of the energy of the orbital, you know, ASPDF. ASPDF 1s 2s 2p 3s 3p 3d 4s 4p 4d. So electron will fill up first of all in the lower energy level, then it will go to the higher energy level. Now how to decide that 3d is of lower energy level and 4s is of higher energy level? For this there is one n plus l rule. All right, now what is l? This is suspense, I will tell you later on. But as of now, know that value of L for S orbital is equal to 0, for P equal to 1, for D value of L is equal to 2, and for F the value of L is equal to 3. And n is nothing but the order of shell. First cell n is 1, second cell n is 2, third cell n is 3, fourth cell n is 4. Now let us find out the value of n for these two. 3d. So n for this is equal to 3 and l for this is equal to 2. Is equal to how much? 5. For 4s, n is equal to 4 and L is equal to 0. So it is 4 only. So 5 is more than 4. Or you can say 4 is the lower energy level. So 4s is the lower energy level and hence it tries to fill up in the 4s orbital prior to 3d. Prior to 3d. So this is Aufbau rule. While filling up of the electron in the atomic orbital of the calcium, we have come across the usage of Aufbau principle. Now, when you will be filling up of the electron, when you will be doing the filling up of electron in the orbitals like this for n number of atoms, every time it will not be possible for you to calculate n plus l. So for that, there is one schematic diagram given. In that schematic diagram, you will understand which orbital has to be filled up at first. To find out the order of filling up of electron, you can write 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 3d, 4s, 4p, 4d, 5s, 5p, 5d, and 4f also, and 5f also. Now, you have to run your order like this. First of all, 1s will fill up, then 2s will fill up, then 2p will fill up, and then 3s will fill up, then 3p will fill up, and then 4s will fill up, then 3d will fill up, and then 4p will fill up, and then s will fill up. Like this. So this is the schematic diagram to decide in which orbital electron should be filled. So today we have seen the atomic structure from orbit and orbital point of view. We have seen the shape and structure of the orbitals. We have tried to fill up the atomic orbital of hydrogen, helium and calcium particularly, because calcium was that particular atom in which the previous methods of K, L, M, N method was not working very well. So we had to consider that K contains S orbital, L contains SP orbital, M contains SPD orbital, M contains SPDF orbital, so on. On doing that, we came across one rule of Aufbau principle, according to which it is said that the electron gets filled up in the low energy at first, and then it goes to the high energy level. To understand which orbital set will have lower energy level, we apply one rule called as N plus L rule. The value of L for S is 0, for P 1, for D 2, and for F 3, like that. The sum of N plus L gives us the idea about its order of energy. Lower will be the order of energy, there the electron will get preferred to be filled in. So, today we have filled up the electron in the calcium. In my next class, we will be filling up the atomic orbitals of the atoms from atomic number 1 to 30. Alright. So you have to remember the name of the atoms from at least 1 to 30. If you have remembered in class 9th and 10th, then big thumbs up to you all. But if you have not remembered and you have taken science or you want to study chemistry, it's high time that you should remember the name of the elements in the periodic table with its due position and the atomic number as early as possible. I can tell you a few trick. What you can do is you can keep the elements written in a row altogether, and then you can pronounce the consonant and vowels in such a way that they become condensed word. Example, if you want to remember the atomic number of hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, like that. So you can write them all together and then you can simply say H helibab C naphnina. If you want to remember magnesium, aluminium, silicon, sulfur, phosphorus, like that, then say H helibab C naphnina MgAl CIPS. Then if you want to remember ClarkCa, means chlorine, argon, potassium, calcium, then Clarka. So in this way you can make your own mnemonic to find out how you can remember the name of the atoms in proper order. Then only we will be able to recall its atomic number and learn about writing the electronic configuration, which is going to be the ABCD of writing chemistry or understanding chemistry in upcoming years and even months. That's it for today. Thank you.